Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I love the songs this morning. Today I'm going to be talking about True Children's Day and also about my experience. Give a short report about my experience at the Pastor's Boot Camp that I went to about 3 weeks ago in New Jersey and New York. Just really moved actually by the See Through Children's Eyes song. We have many kinds of love, right? There's many different kinds of love, right? Four realms of heart. And I think what I've been using a lot actually recently in my life when I get stressed out or don't know what to do, or I'll try to like just go be with my kids and just, or think about my kids, and you know, their attitude as young kids is so pure. You know, it's one of the things I think that in our fallen world hasn't been affected so much. And you know, I think that's something we can all learn from is, you know, children, like their love for their parents, or children's love is, you know, I mean, I was even thinking about it, you know, making a decision about church and using the building for an event. I'm like, what would my kids do? You know, what would their perspective be? You know, and like the song was saying, it's like, I guess one of the things to take on this week, I would ask you, is to do that, to see through children's eyes. So True Children's Day. Yesterday we celebrated True Children's Day. We'll be distributing the holy items later. Thank everybody that came. It was very nice celebration. Thank you to the Sama family for cleaning up and setting everything up. And I wanted to read a few words from Chumpy Mogyong and also from Dr. Kim. She gave a speech about the true meaning of True Children's Day, so that's what we'll speak about. But first, I want to start with the Children's Day related, not related, children kind of related joke. Okay, so what do elves learn in school?
The alphabet.
Oh. All right, great. So that has absolutely nothing to do with the
topic. There it is, the alphabet.
There it is, the alphabet.
Without it.
So I'm going to read some Trupada's words. Trupada's prayer, actually, from the 10th True Children's Day. I actually like to ask a few people to read. Could I ask, maybe Jack, would you mind reading this?
True Father's Prayer, 10th Children's Day. I hope and pray that you will allow all your children to become true children based on their relationship to true parents, to build true families based on being true children, and based on those true families to expand into true tribes, true peoples, true nations, a true world, and a true cosmos.
Thank you. So, you know, in some ways I think we hear these kinds of things so many times it sometimes becomes kind of dull, like I get dull, but one of the things that, you know, I was struck by reading this was True Father just is always thinking on like this huge level, you know, that is really amazing, you know, this global eternal level, talking about a true world and a true cosmos. It's such a vision that you want to, you know, you want to be a part of, you want to give so much meaning, you know, to our lives. And the other thing was that we are all, there's one thing that everyone has in common, and we are all children. And he starts to talk about the relationship that how becoming true children is really based on their relationship to true parents. So, you know, I think that's going to be kind of a key point from today, is, you know, being true children is really comes from being true, from our relationship to true parents. So this is what I mentioned, Bishop Kim, Dr. Kim's message last year at True Children's Day. In the Champumogyam, who are the true children? We are. You are true children. What True Father defined as true children was whoever inherited the spirit of true parents. You carry true parents' spirit. You are the true children. So we are all true children. We are all true children, and we celebrate this more than anybody else. We take ownership of this day, for this day. Through messages, through truth, true parents really restore some essential foundations and our God-centered heart. This is the meaning behind our celebration today. We become true parents, true children, and true owners, and we are related to God's blood lineage through true parents' blessing and true parents' love. This is the meaning for why today we become true children. According to true parents, all human beings from this day on, I bless each one of you. You are true children centered on true parents, and this is the meaning of today. This is the meaning of today. I just was struck by how it's about, you know, we are the true children. I didn't really consider that. You know, we, all of us, everybody, like I mentioned before, what any person in the world has in common is they are children, they have parents. And by inheriting from true parents, we can be true children, we have that position. And, you know, when he says we are true children, I think that it's kind of like saying it's in there, it's in you, you know, and it's something that we have to kind of realize that we have it, you know, it's there, and we have things to do, we have steps to take to be that. True Children's Day is about inheriting from true parents. Okay, so, you know, that's all I have about True Children's Day. I wanted to also just bring up one point that, you know, our movement is, one of the things I think is really amazing is that we focus on love so much, and, you know, it's just, love is just, it's so great. Like, I mean, like, anything you want to achieve in your life, if you use love or, you know, true love, you'll achieve it. You know, like, you want to, you know, I mean, if true love was there, and, you know, in the difficult problems in the world, in politics, or in whatever I'm doing with my relationship with my wife, or, you know, just this, like, yeah, letting go of myself. I was just really struck by this kind of, like, peaceful warmth that we have as a community, and I think True Children's Day is a wonderful, you know, wonderful time to remember that, like, that warmth of family and love and children. So, That concludes my part about True Children's Day. That's all I have for that. I don't really know how to easily segue this into the Pastor's Boot Camp, but I really wanted to share with you about really great experience I had, you know, in, again, just a few weeks ago, we were at the Clifton Church. I know some people used to live in New Jersey, right? Anybody used to live in New Jersey, go to Clifton Church?
I lived in New Jersey for a long time.
Yeah, okay. Just John?
Clifton.
Jack?
Patterson. Passaic.
Everybody's migrating from New Jersey. All right. Well, can you switch to the pictures? So I had about a on the top right, on the three dots in the top right, the three dot in the top right corner. There's
one in black or in white. This one.
Yeah. That.
Oh, okay.
And slideshow. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just click. And then pause it. Okay, so these are one of the pastor couple that was there. They're from Miami. I'm gonna go through some pictures and then share some highlights, and then that'll be it for today. But yeah, I was there for, what was it? How long was it? 3 days. Anyways, anyways, I'll show you the schedule. I don't even remember how many days it was, but it was really great. So I'll go through the pictures first. The purpose of the boot camp was to be, you know, was to get, you know, get tools, get really connected with materials, get some training to be a pastor. To, you know, the goal is to have all of our pastors in our movement be, you know, at a certain level, have certain resources that they need, and just get support. So one of the key things that we got from there was mentorship, basically, from one of our elder pastors. I think has probably been one of the pastors the longest in our movement is Reverend Thompson from the Bay Area Family Church. He was there. He was core staff for the workshop. So there were about 15 people there, two staff from headquarters and Reverend Thompson. This is a new pastors in Miami. We had great food. This is in Clifton Church. We had great food throughout the program. Next. You know, maybe you can get a small sense of the people there. So we had a pastor from Chicago. Don't remember. Anyways, we got to all get really close with everybody. Everybody here. Oh yeah, Hero, his name. This pastor from DC, pastors from Alabama, pastor from Ohio, from Belvedere, UTS, right? Anyways, I think UTS area. Next slide. First day was in headquarters. This is the headquarters conference room. And we did Hunuke every morning at 6 here with Reverend Busing with Reverend Busing or someone else from headquarters. This is the pastor for the Spanish community in New York. Next slide. Jario Gavin, maybe some of you know him, now pastor in Alabama. One wonderful thing about this was just to get close with other pastors. Jari also has young children like me, so he could really exchange ideas, you know, how do we manage being pastor. Jari has
Gavin, one of the Gavin boys?
Gavin boy, yeah.
Youngest.
country, aren't they?
Who? The Gavins. No. Next slide. Oh, actually, go. Can you go back? Maybe you can kind of see.
What?
Yeah, back. On the right, can we turn off a little bit of lights? I don't know. Anyways, this is the lady on the right. Susan. Lady on the right is Susan Watchery. She's in charge of what's the word for it?
Human resources.
Yes, human resources. So she was one of the core staff for the program. Just wonderful member. Next page. Next slide. One of the pastors in New Jersey area. I don't know, he's not a pastor, but one of the assistant pastors in the New Jersey area. Next slide. From the Philippines originally. So this was a chance where we got to go to East Garden. We actually got a tour of East Garden by longtime, I don't know how to share his title properly, but
he was like the maintenance guy. It's Paul Fontaine.
Yes, right. Yeah, maintenance guy, but a bit more than that, right? You wouldn't say
a bit more than that.
Yeah, very.
He's an icon.
Yeah, very, very close to Chopin. So we got a wonderful.
His wife was head of the kitchen there.
Yes,
also.
That's right. Yeah, we got to. She actually made some food for us, and we really got spoiled. This is one of the security guards that was security for Chopin's. Mari Curry, this is one of our vice presidents at UPF. Also one of the core staff. Next slide. Next. Ian Jaria. More pictures of the pastors right outside of East Garden. Next. Go ahead, next. So, yeah, it was pretty amazing to actually be in East Garden. True Parents lived in this building. I have been, is this normal? Do people go in here? Have you been in here? Anybody?
Yeah, we've been in there before.
Many people. I guess this is normal, right? Because many people, there were many
meetings
and stuff, right?
Yeah, they used to be
meetings. Okay, that's right. Okay, thanks. It was wonderful to we got to hear about, True Parents. Yeah, just stories about True Parents, about True Parents family. Next. Next slide. This is the prayer room in True Parents' house. Next slide. So there are a couple members that have been, living and taking care of and being with True Family for many years that are now working on creating, I guess you could say, heirlooms. I'm not sure if that's the right word for it, but taking, things that True Parents used and, making them into like pins or like clothes that your mother has worn in the past, and so I actually brought a few of those, and I want to give them to you. I didn't bring them today, but bring those in the future next Sunday. Let's go to the next slide. This is a picture. Next slide. I feel like I've seen, I feel a bit ignorant with this, but anyways, I feel like I've seen this room in pictures, but I actually have to go there. Can you go, keep going? Next slide. There's like a rock inside one of the buildings in East Garden with a waterfall in it. Next slide. Next slide. I was just amazed. Next. And some of the fish that drew Father Khan. They're building this whole area into a museum to honor True Parents. Yeah. And we got trained to be how to do an offering table, how to conduct the holy day. Thanks. By Paul
Fontaine
himself. Next. And really got to get close with all of the other pastors and share. Next. And even got an award. Again, this is in the Clifton Family Church Sanctuary. This is a pastor of your community now. New pastor in Michigan. Oh, and assistant pastor in Belvedere. Next slide. Great. Okay, so I just want to go through a few of the highlights. So, okay, it was much more than 3 days. 5 days. And, just to give you a schedule, it was pretty packed. Program. So, I think really one of the biggest things, there are many things, but we got, very relevant lectures about how to be a pastor, what are important things about being a pastor. I'm just going to go through things chronologically. One thing was we got, in the first day, we got a headquarters tour and we got to meet with the ministry team leaders. So it was just, the thing that stuck for me for that was that we have about 50, more than 50% of people working at headquarters are younger members. And it's really exciting. And I actually know many of them personally. So just a lot of, a lot of hope in that sense. A lot of the department leaders are also younger members. And we got a report from each of them about their activities for the year, which is really great. Another big highlight was we had that 9 p.m. on Thursday was one of the lectures, a schedule you can live with, and Reverend Thompson shared what he does to manage his schedule as a pastor. It's really practical. Like everything that was shared was practical. I could tell that they were listening from feedback from past boot camps to make things relevant. Another one of the lectures that was really beneficial was about some of the challenges that we're facing. Generational challenges, financial challenges, and some solutions for that, all from Reverend Thompson. One of the things that stuck out to me was that we have, about 80% of our tithe as a nationwide movement is coming from our elder members. And, 5 to 10 years, many of those members will retire or just get older. So we really have to be serious about what are we going to do to handle that. I mean, it's a very pretty serious problem. And actually, one of the things we realized during this was that many of the problems we're facing, it's not just our movement, actually. Even businesses are facing these problems of how to inspire the millennials, right? How to have them be, consistent or dedicated to a job, or other churches. Other churches are having the exact same similar things that we're dealing with. So it's kind of, I actually thought, wow, we have this opportunity to be the example for the world of how to really have a intergenerational, successful movement and solve these problems that everybody's, asking about. Mm-hmm. We had, another huge thing, I mean, probably the biggest thing that I got from the whole thing was really connecting to true parents again through the workshop, and connecting to the importance of a pastor in a community, and realizing that I am the spiritual representative, spiritual leader for the community. And I kind of knew that in my head, but just kind of understanding and realizing the gravity of that, and also got some tools, like, what can I do? And one of the things that Reverend Thompson shared, he shared about the spiritual life of a pastor, and how that's really the most important thing about everything. Forget about your schedule, forget about your getting a good sermon. The most important thing is your spiritual life. And that included, he shared about your family, your relationship with your family. And one of the things that I heard from that was relationship, your spiritual life, one of the most important things there that is just discipline, is continuing to do things, consistency, consistently praying, consistently reading. And that was actually really liberating for me, because I was always thinking, how do I have a good spiritual life? I don't know what to do. I don't feel connected to God. I don't, I don't have inspirations enough. And Kevin Thompson says, everybody deals with that. And one thing that you can do is discipline. And even Trufant, he shared Trufant's words about the same thing. It feels really hot in here. Is it just me?
It's hotter up there.
What do you?
The stage is hotter.
The stage.
Yeah, it feels different.
All right. Well, I'll come down. All right. There's a thing over there called Generation IQ Fishbowl. So we had this. Activity where everybody got in a circle, and then one person from the younger generation and one person from the older generation came together and shared the views of their generation, right, to the other, and they tried to have a conversation about something like, why don't the second generation come to church, I think was one of the discussions or something like that. And that was awesome. It's just, it was really like a very free, honest, open environment for just discussion. Like, what can we do? How did the younger generation feel? How did the elder generation feel? Let's listen to each other. Also, amazing. If you've ever listened to Kevin Thompson, he is an amazing speaker, and his sermons are wonderful, right? Anybody?
Yes.
Anybody listen? Yeah, I agree. So he gave a really, really content-filled talk about crafting a sermon, crafting a message. We also got to hear from testimonies from other pastors. We talked a lot about younger generation and how to inspire them, and we got to hear testimonies from pastors and communities that have increased, significant increase in attendance by the young adults. So we got connected with those communities and got to hear from them and got to hear practical things that they're doing.
Such as,
well, one of the things that couple did is the Colorado Family Church. They said they visited invited young families to their house. They went through and invited most of the young families, not just young families, but young adults in, for dinner. That's one of the things that they shared about that. Yeah, I think really those are most of the main points. I didn't go in chronological order at all. I think I guess one of the things that I wanna say is that I felt so much the care of the headquarters, staff of the headquarters community. Can we turn on the lights again? Are we here? John got it. And thank you everybody for giving me the opportunity to go there. I was really motivated, really inspired. I really feel much better equipped. I think that any pastor from our community could go and learn something from that, new or not new. That's basically it. Any question you guys want to ask about it? I also have some materials I want to share with you if you'd like to take a look at them. Different materials that we got, like papers, blessing materials, some outreach materials. So I'll put those in the back afterwards, and you can feel free to take a look. Anyone have any question they want to ask?
Yes, is the Clifton Church service on Sunday one of the main services now in that area of New Jersey?
Yeah.
Or is it just one of many? I mean, it sounds like the Clifton Church is sort of...
They have another, I know that they have another church service in
Where Rock?
Elizabeth?
I don't know the name of the place, but the church is it's a Korean church, and I know there are, that's been growing, and there's some members that go to that church service. That's what I'm aware of.
You were at the Clifton Church service on that Sunday, right?
Yeah. I was at the Clifton Church.
What kind of building was it?
It's a big it's a church. It's a three-story building. I think it's been there for many years, so if you've been there before, it might be the same one. But it's like a three-story building. I think they have maybe a basement.
It's a local church they bought.
Oh,
Methodist or something.
Okay.
Say anything about music?
Yes, they did actually. Reverend Thompson pretty much said that music is probably the most important part of Sunday service. He said music is like a prayer, like a prayer for many people. It's really their way to connect to God. So, thank you, music ministry, for always being here and providing us some great music. Should we give them a quick hand?
Yeah.
Any other questions? Last question. You can always ask me afterwards. Yeah.
What was your most inspiring experience?
I think actually the most inspiring experience was I'm sitting at the conference table at headquarters. It's this like big reddish brown table, and we're reading the Chunkum Ogyum. I'm reading, hearing Chunkum Ogyum, and it's a letter from True Father to True Mother when he was in America, I believe, and she was pregnant somewhere, and he was on a tour, and it was really, really moving. True Father talking about, True Mother, please take care of your health, please pray. I'm thinking about you. I miss you. It was so beautiful. It was almost like a love letter, very, very deep. through the Home to Care, you know, I got connected with True Mother and True Father's heart more, like their relationship to each other. We read about how True Mother never complained, you know, ever. And yeah, just that, I think that was probably one of the most moving, things. Okay, thank you, everybody. Please join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Parents, thank you today for the foundation that we stand on, Heavenly Parents, the foundation for that, that's there for True Children's Day to be established, for us to be here in this church community, the foundation of True Parents, foundation of our of all the people that have worked in our community, in this nation, Heavenly Parents. Heavenly Parents, all the people that contributed to our families, thank you for that, Heavenly Parents. We're coming up to a time of gratitude, a time of thanks. Heavenly Parents, help us to be bright and clear and happy, Heavenly Parents, just like children, Heavenly Parents. This week, we want to take on loving like children, Heavenly Parents. And thank you for all the blessings that we have here in the Triangle Family Church community. I report this all in the name of Joshua and Maria Angelucci. Bless Central Family. Amen.